Philippine National Police says dismissed Mayor Alice Go would likely be transferred to the Pasig City Jail on Monday. She was originally scheduled to be brought to the facility on Friday, but it did not push through due to incomplete paperwork.
Yung mga supposedly mag-examine po sa kanya at mag-certify po doon sa ibang mga test po ay wala na po kasi almost past 9 time na po ata yon nung nadala po siya sa hospital po. Kaya they have to wait for the some papers po. So ang stand po ng PNP nung hindi po matapos itong mga proseso po na ito ay they have to return first the warrant of arrest issued by RTC Branch 167.
The Pasig City Regional Trial Court ordered the transfer in connection with Go's non-bailable qualified trafficking case. Jail authorities assure the public Go will be treated like any other detainee. The House Quad Committee vows to show the alleged connection of dismissed Philippine Mayor Alice Guo and Pogo Representative Cassandra Ong to criminal syndicates in the next hearing. Another suspected Pogo personality, Tony Yang, is also expected to appear before the joint House panel. This report from Jeffrey Anais.
The House Quad Committee is set to present a matrix allegedly linking former Bamban Tarlac Mayor Alice Go and Cassandra Lee Ong to Pogo operations and the Chinese Triad in the next hearing. According to House Committee on Human Rights Chairperson, Congressman Bienvenido Abante Jr., they have documents to support these claims.
Ilalabas namin yan at the proper time. Pero most in the matrix, no, are either Chinese or Filipino-Chinese. At kasama dyan, si Cassie. At si Alice Go'o, that claim to be Filipinos. Pero sa aming pong pag-aaral, si Cassie po ay hindi po yan Filipino. Chinese po siya.
Lawmakers say they will dig deep into the alleged connection of Go and Ong to criminal syndicates such as the Chinese Triad and Fujian Gang. Last Thursday, the Joint House panel questioned why many of Go and Ong's business partners are from the Chinese province of Fujian.
Tingay na ng either ng Chinese Triad yan o ng Fujian Gang to answer the way that they answered.
So kung may allegation ka, ilabas mo para hindi nasisira yung pangalan ng tao kung wala ka ng ebidensya.
Meanwhile, Ong's lawyer accused the lower house of abusing its powers after issuing a second contempt citation against his client.
Eh bakit sila pong mga mambabatas ang lumalabag sa batas? I want to remind them, sila po ay mambabatas, hindi po sila ang batas.
They could be able to invoke that the right that they have, yet they cannot evade the questions asked to them.
Ong's camp has previously filed a petition asking the Supreme Court to compel legislators to acknowledge her right to remain silent or refuse to answer questions. Many personalities are expected to appear in the next hearing, including Tony Yang, the brother of Michael Yang, who is a former Duterte economic advisor. Congressman Dan Fernandez says Yang owns several businesses connected to industrial steel and rice importation. The older Yang also goes by several names including Yang Jean Shin and Antonio Lim.
May mga hawak kaming dokumento na siya nagtatago ng mga pera, no? To the tune of about 8 billion pesos. Siya ang nagtitimon ng mga Yang brothers.
Yang remains in the custody of the Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission after being arrested at NAIA last Thursday. Meanwhile, Myla Roque, the wife of former presidential spokesperson Harry Roque, fired back at Congressman Robert Ace Barbers, who linked her to Pogo operations. She called the lawmaker an abusive individual. She also claimed of malicious interpretation when she submitted her medical records. Mrs. Roque also said Barbers cannot label her family as broken. A show cause order was issued against Mrs. Roque for failing to attend the QuadCom hearings. Meantime, Barbers, the overall chair of the QuadCom, denies abusing his immunity from libel. Barbers, who is also chairman of the Committee on Dangerous Drugs, explained Mrs. Roque was not linked to Lucky South 99, but only her husband. Her name, according to Barbers, cropped up in the hearings because she was the one who signed the lease agreement to a wanted Chinese IT expert. The Chinese fugitive was later arrested at a property leased by Biancham Holdings and Trading Incorporated, which is owned by the Roque family. The lawmaker also clarified the issue on Mrs. Roque's medical records, noting that the documents she submitted was unclear on the health issues she was facing. For barbers, if the Roque couple has nothing to hide, they should just attend the QuadCom hearings, be transparent, and open all their cards. Jeffrey Hernaez, ABS-CBN News.
Criminal charges are eyed by the Philippine Justice Department against the lawyers of dismissed Town Mayor Alice Guo. This would be over discrepancies in the documents they submitted in relation to the complaints their client is facing. Justice Undersecretary Nicholas T. says a team has been formed to look into possible administrative or criminal liability of Guo's lawyers. He's also not ruling out a case of disbarment.
That's clearly a very serious concern for us, the submission of fake documents in our proceedings. It's one of the things that's being considered, but we have to realize that disbarment is quite a very serious result. So disciplinary proceedings against lawyers can result in many things. It can result in something as serious as a disbarment, as minor as an admonishment. So right now, we're just open to anything. We're looking into what's possible out there, and we're going to take action in due time.
Former Vice President Lenny Robredo responds to criticism sparked by the surprised House visit of Vice President Sara Duterte, who is known for cutting remarks against opposition figures. Katrina Domingo has details.
Everyone is welcome. This is what former Vice President Lenny Robredo said a day after she hosted Vice President Sara Duterte and other high-ranking government officials in her home in Naga City.
Kasi pagpanya friend siya dito sa amin, wala namang kulay ng politika tinitingnan. Walang partido, politically neutral dito lahat. Lahat na pumupunta para kay Ina ay welcome dito sa amin.
Other officials who visited Robredo include Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos and Senator Bong Revilla, two politicians allied with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., Robredo's rival, both in the 2016 and 2022 elections. Robredo explains their family has always been welcoming politicians from different parties every feast of the Peña Francia, a decades-long practice which began in the late 80s.
Mula nung naging mayor yung asawa ko, 1988, ganito na, every time na may bisita yung Naga, si Ina, yung sadya, very much welcome dito sa aming bahay.
But this kind of hospitality did not sit well for some of Robredo's supporters, as Vice President Duterte has once labeled her predecessor as a fake vice president, while her family has been taunting the opposition leader for years while their patriarch, Rodrigo Duterte, was still in power. Former Senator Antonio Trillanes is among Robredo's allies who questioned her decision to entertain Duterte, noting that the Davaoena politician has repeatedly disrespected opposition figures in the past. Trillanes says it was wrong for Robredo to even meet Duterte, as the former vice president allegedly allowed herself to be part of her successor's propaganda. The office of the vice president earlier released a statement saying Duterte was invited to take part in the Peña Francia festivities this weekend. The OVP adds that the Bicolano who invited Duterte to the feast is the same person who arranged a casual meeting between the former and incumbent vice presidents. Duterte's office also noted that Robredo was only among the many Bicolano personalities that the vice president visited during her trip to Bicol. Political analyst Edmund Tayo explains it is difficult not to paint Duterte and Robredo's meeting without a splash of political color, especially as Robredo stood as the main opposition figure during the Duterte administration.
Even if you're attending fiesta, there has to be a reason why you're going to go out of your way to meet a political leader. One can only think that the objective is political, perhaps to explore some kind of understanding between the two of them and perhaps see if the opposition can find a way to act together.
When asked if it is possible for Duterte and Robredo to set aside their differences and broker a deal for the upcoming midterm elections.
In Philippine politics, it's not always about political parties. Anything is possible, to be honest.
Meantime, Robredo's spokesperson says politics was not part of the conversations in Naga, and that Robredo's hospitality towards the sitting vice president only proves the Bicolana leader's class. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
The anniversary of the martial law declaration in the Philippines met with protests by groups who say similar rights abuses continue under the Marcos Jr. administration. Andrea Taguines reports.
The youth, women, labor groups, activists, and martial law survivors. People from different sectors took to the streets on Saturday as the Philippines marked the 52nd anniversary of the Declaration of Martial Law, which is considered as one of the darkest chapters of the country's history. It was in September 21, 1972, when former President Ferdinand Marcos Sr. signed Proclamation 1081, placing the Philippines under martial rule. Thousands of dissenters were arrested, tortured, and killed. Although democracy has since been restored in the country, a documentarist and brother of desaparecidos Jonas Burgos believes traces of the dictatorship remain until today.
Under Marcos Jr., meron ng 12 nadudukot at namimising hanggang sa kasalukuyan. Ibig sabihin, ang nangyari sa aking kuya no nangyari noong 2007 at nangyari sa martial law victims ng mga disappeared ay nagpapatuloy hanggang sa moment na ito.
There are also those who welcome the efforts of the current Marcos Jr. administration to investigate former President Rodrigo Duterte and the killings under his watch. But martial law victim Bonifacio Ilagan isn't entirely convinced.
Na yung mga nangyayaring investigasyon sa Kongreso, sabi nila, ayan, nagbabago na, nabubuking na yung mga kasalanan ng nakaraan. Without realizing na ang pinatutunguhan naman ng mga ito ay para lalong ma-entrench, para lalong lumakas sa kapangyarihan ang isang faction. Everything is a war between the political dynasties.
In the end, the protesters failed to reach Menjola and get near the Malacañang Palace as hundreds of police officers blocked their path. Some demonstrators tried to push forward, but the authorities shoved them back with their plastic shields.
Maximum tolerance, ma'am. Hindi po kami, sa harangan lang po namin. Yun po.
Sir, bakit hindi sila pwedeng dumiretso?
Yun po ang utos namin, ma'am.
Warning, Bongbong Marcos. Hindi mo pwedeng sikilin ang boses ng mamamayan.
Elsewhere in Manila, pro-Duterte group Maysug also staged the rally, denouncing the martial law years at Liwasang Bonifacio. In Davao, it was the students of the University of the Philippines, Mindanao, that led the mobilization. They expressed their opposition to the UP-AFP Declaration of Cooperation and the alleged military presence in their campus. Meanwhile, in Cebu, progressive groups also mounted protest actions to condemn both the Marcos Jr. and Duterte administrations for supposedly failing to deliver genuine social justice.
This year also marks the third martial law anniversary under President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., the son and namesake of the former dictator. And just like the previous years, Malacañang has stayed silent on the issue. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Former Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte insists he has no bad blood against his successor. He spoke Friday at a convention of his political party PDP Laban in Davao City. Duterte acknowledged he may not always agree with President Marcos, but his only appeal is that Marcos governs without favoritism. Duterte's comments come amid the widening rift between his daughter, Vice President Sara Duterte, and Mr. Marcos. Earlier this year, Duterte accused Marcos of illegal drug use, an allegation that the president simply laughed off.
I don't have any qualms against Marcos. Serious enough for me to speak out and say, Mr. President, we do not agree with you. Mr. President, you are wrong. And Mr. President, you stop it. Kasi hindi na maganda sa bayan niya. I have not reached that point.
The election season now being felt in the Philippines as various personalities are already announcing their decision to run for the 2025 midterm polls. House Speaker Martin Romualdez, Lakas CMD Party, picks the group's chairperson, Senator Bong Revilla, as their first candidate for the Senate race. Meanwhile, two incumbent senators and an actor joined the senatorial slate of the Duterte-led Partido Democratikong Pilipino, or PDP. Senators Christopher Bongo and Ronald De La Rosa, as well as actor Philip Salvador, will gun for a Senate seat next year. Former Senator Kiko Pangilinan will also be attempting to return to the upper chamber, under the banner of the Liberal Party. Meanwhile, Pangilinan's ally, former Senator Leila De Lima, will seek a congressional seat under the Mamamayang Liberal Party list, together with former lawmakers Teddy Bagilat and Erin Tanyada. Former Vice President Lenny Robredo also announced she will be running for mayor in Naga City. Manila's mission to patrol close to Escoda Shoal in the West Philippine Sea is back on track with the deployment of the combined assets of the Coast Guard, the Armed Forces, but operational details are being kept under wraps. Michael Deriso has tonight's top story.
Nearly a week since the return of the Philippine Coast Guard's largest vessel, the BRP Teresa Magbanua, to its home port in Palawan, the National Maritime Council on Saturday said replacements have been deployed to maintain the country's presence and monitor China's activities in Escoda Shoal. The deployment consists of combined assets of the PCG and the Armed Forces of the Philippines. But unlike before, the Philippines is keeping details of the patrol mission confidential, including their area of operation and number of ships as part of a new strategy.
Mas maganda nga yung nahuhula sila kung saan. Kasi pag alam na kung nasaan, doon sila pupunta. Men yung parang magnet siya. No? So that is our approach, na hindi as much as possible na hindi natin i-reveal kung nasan sila.
Ray Powell, director of South China Sea Monitor Sea Light, says he cannot see any Philippine ships at Escoda Shoal. However, he admits the Filipino vessels could have turned off their automatic identification system, or AIS, to avoid getting tracked. Despite this possible scenario, Powell said he observed Chinese ships becoming active, including one Chinese vessel racing towards Palawan. Eight additional Chinese maritime militia ships have also left China's military base in Panganiban Reef. Their expected destination is Escoda Shoal. Chinese ships have been swarming the area even before the BRP Teresa Magbanua cut short its Escoda mission. Maritime security analyst Chester Cabalza agrees with the Philippines' new strategy.
Labanan ngayon ito ng mga strategiya, labanan ito ng operasyon. So, hayaan lang natin muna na gawin ng Coast Guard natin yung dapat nilang gawin para lalong lumakas yung kanilang pwersa.
Cabalza also expressed support for Manila's decision to maintain independence in its missions despite a U.S. offer to provide escorts.
Sagot natin ito. Problema natin ito. Mm-hmm. Hindi kinakailangan na iasa natin sa mga kaibigan natin itong problema na ito. Mas maganda na ipinapakita natin na lumalaban tayo.
He also expressed the need to expedite the Philippines' military modernization and called on the public to support the Coast Guard and Armed Forces. For the National Maritime Council, foreign assistance will only be considered if the country has exhausted all options.
Hindi porke may ganitong problema ay dudulong kaagad tayo. So meron tayong tinatawag na sense of pride or dignity as a nation na kung kain naman natin, tayo muna.
Meantime, the Philippines continues to forge new defense partnerships with other countries. The Royal Malaysian Navy was recently in Manila for a dialogue with the Philippine Navy, and both parties reaffirmed their commitment to closer defense relations. Senior Defense Undersecretary Ireneo Espino and Germany's State Secretary for Defense Nils Hilmer also met following the port call of the German Navy's warship in Manila. The two sides also reaffirmed the importance of deepening cooperation, particularly in the fields of training and education, peacekeeping operations, cybersecurity, and defense industry. Michael Deliso, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine poll body looking to release next week the names of party list organizations that would be allowed to participate in the May 2025 polls. COMELEC Chairperson George Garcia says all pending cases need to be resolved first before the poll body can release the list. The period for filing of the list of nominees and certificate of nomination and acceptance will be from October 1st to October 8th. A total of 177 party lists sought seats during the May 2022 elections. The Philippines' anti-cybercrime office sees deepfakes on the internet as the biggest technology threat to next year's midterm elections. The agency on Saturday warned this technology could be used to create fake videos of personalities that could deliver manipulated messages. It said efforts are underway to identify a software that could detect and counter deepfakes. The Commission on Elections is also working with the ICT department to monitor content that could undermine the elections.
The public will be
misled by a lot of content. So hindi na natin alam kung ano magiging totoo at anong hindi. Gusto nila i-measure na rin yung exposure na kada candidate and those who are propagating false information. So we are focused on that.
Philippine health experts raise the alarm over the rising number of young cancer patients in the country. The Philippine Society of Oncologists says they are treating patients in some hospitals who are younger than 40 years old, which they say is a new trend. The group's president says there are some factors driving an increase in the cases among young people, including lifestyle and environment. Dr. Herdy Luna is calling for stronger initiatives to detect cancers in patients early on.
We have more air pollution. We have still smoking as all around us. Alcohol drinking and also limited exercise. Possibly these are the new triggers, no, na affecting the young. The more proactive one is being able to consider the vaccinations, cervical vaccinations, early as 9 to 12 years old. Through vaccination, as much as 90% that prevent yung mga cervical cancer severe types.